People generally tend to think about proteins, carbs, calories, but no one really thinks about the individual amino acids. In most people's minds, these amino acids are probably all just kind of the same. But maybe they're not. Let me show you something. Here's a graph. It shows what happens to mice if you restrict their intake of a single amino acid. Do you see what happens to mice who have had their intake of this one amino acid restricted? Those mice end up living 20% longer than the mice who consumed a normal diet.
Because we hot and we young.
This effect that you're seeing here only happens when you restrict one specific amino acid. That amino acid being, of course,
who's that amino acid? It's methionine!
Methionine. No other amino acid behaves this way. In fact, in a different experiment, a team of scientists were able to demonstrate that restricting methionine from the diet had some very extremely impressive anti-cancer effects. In this study, the scientists investigated the effects of methionine restriction on cancer growth by injecting melanoma cells into mice and dividing the mice into three groups. The first group continued to consume a normal diet. The second group had its methionine intake restricted, while the third group was provided a diet that was completely devoid or deficient in methionine. And here were their findings, clear as day. The less methionine the mice consumed, the fewer metastases that they developed, the longer that they survived, and the smaller their tumors were in size. In fact, if you look closely enough, you'll see that when a methionine-deficient diet was combined with radiotherapy, tumor growth was brought to a complete halt, something that clearly did not happen with radiotherapy alone, where the tumors continued to grow and grow and grow. What is going on here? Why is this essential amino acid trying to kill us? My name is Hashim and I'm a medical doctor, and today I'll be telling you all about methionine because I think it's really interesting and I'm sure you'll find it interesting too. Now, this is probably the point where I should mention that in the cancer experiments we were just talking about, the scientists noted that the mice that had their methionine intake restricted lost the most weight, despite suffering from the least cancer burden. That's odd. Having less tumor growth, fewer metastases, and longer survival should have reduced the cancer burden and reduced weight loss, not increased it. Even more interesting, despite their high cancer burden, the mice that enjoyed a diet abundant in methionine experienced weight gain despite their cancer. This is actually not at all that surprising, because we know from other studies that when healthy 6-week baby mice are put on a methionine-restricted diet, they end up losing 20% of their body weight and 40% of their body fat in just under 40 days, compared to their peers who consumed a normal methionine-abundant diet. This all despite the methionine-restricted mice consuming 20% more food. So methionine restriction is making these baby mice eat more, but still lose weight and body fat, all the while extending their lifespan and protecting them against cancer. To understand how methionine restriction can do this, and conversely how methionine consumption can do the opposite, we need to take a closer look at mTOR. mTOR is one of the central regulators of cellular metabolism. It integrates nutrient and growth signals like growth factors, amino acids, and energy availability, communicating the availability of these resources to the rest of the cell, stimulating cell growth and proliferation, as well as inhibiting autophagy, which is a type of programmed cell death where old or dysfunctional cells and organelles are allowed to die and be recycled. mTOR has gained a lot of attention in recent years because of the rise of an experimental anti-aging drug that you may have heard of, rapamycin. Rapamycin inhibits mTOR, so it prevents cells from growing and proliferating. It also stimulates autophagy. And according to research on mice from the Harvard Medical School, it is definitely increasing lifespan as well, as it mimics the effects of caloric restriction on the body. But why am I telling you all of this? It's because while rapamycin inhibits mTOR, methionine actually does the opposite. It stimulates mTOR. When methionine is consumed in a diet, it's typically broken down and metabolized into S-adenosyl methionine, which we'll just call SAM for short, which in turn stimulates SAMTOR and phosphatase 2A, which then go on to activate mTOR. SAMTOR and phosphatase 2A act as nutrient signals for mTOR, They communicate that there is an abundance of nutrients, specifically amino acids like methionine, in the body, and inform mTOR that it should instruct the cell to grow and proliferate. This explains why consuming methionine can be so bad in cancer. Methionine consumption stimulates cells to grow and proliferate. This includes healthy but also cancerous cells, meaning methionine consumption will encourage cancer to grow and metastasize, as we've seen in some of the experiments that we've mentioned earlier. It also explains why methionine restriction results in weight loss. In a way, methionine restriction is similar to taking a rapamycin supplement. Here's a picture that shows twin mice. The difference is that the one on the right-hand side received rapamycin, while the one on the left-hand side did not. With rapamycin, mTOR is inhibited and growth and proliferation are limited, so you get smaller mice. You should expect to see similar findings with methionine restriction. One thing that remains unexplained, however, is that methionine restriction extends lifespan. And that's because it's really not immediately obvious why restricting growth and proliferation in a healthy mouse or human that does not have cancer or any similar disease or condition might lead to that animal having a longer lifespan. So the answer to this question actually lies in a 2015 research paper published in Nature by a team of scientists from the University of Tokyo. Now, the premise of their research was actually really interesting, because they started off with this idea that methionine was not the problem, that methionine consumption did not shorten lifespan, that methionine did not result in aging, and did not cause the diseases that we associate with old age. Because if you think about it, young people tend to have very similar diets to middle-aged or older people. At least, they certainly won't differ wildly in their methionine consumption. After all, methionine is an essential amino acid that's found in fish, meat, dairy products, and all sorts of other things. So there was no reason to believe that young people were healthier because they consumed a lot less methionine. But what if the problem wasn't methionine, but the breakdown product of methionine? If you remember a little while ago, I mentioned that it wasn't methionine that activated mTOR, but the breakdown product of methionine, S-adenosylmethionine, or SAM. Well, if you think about it, just like methionine needs to be broken down into its breakdown product, methionine's breakdown product, SAM, also needs to be broken down. And SAM is broken down by an enzyme called glycine N-methyltransferase. Let's just call it GNMT for short. Now, choosing to give mice a much-needed break and using fruit flies as their animal models, the scientists from Japan were able to show that the problem lay in the GNMT and not the methionine. In short, what seems to be happening is this. When you're young, you've got plenty of GNMT to go around. This helps you break down SAM so it doesn't build up within your cells. This changes, however, as you age, or as we all age, and GNMT expression decreases, meaning that SAM starts to build up, despite us consuming roughly the same amount of methionine as we always did in our diet. As SAM accumulates in the cells, it chronically activates mTOR, leading to aging, diseases we associate with old age, and a shorter lifespan overall. The scientists confirmed this by introducing a mutation in the gene that codes for GNMT so that it becomes overexpressed, showing that the fruit flies that had this mutation regain their young phenotype, even in their old age, as the mutation that overexpressed GNMT helped prevent the accumulation of SAM and chronic mTOR activation. In fact, the fruit flies that had this mutation lived 15% longer, very similar to the mice from the experiment that we started this video off with. Of course, at the end of the day, as we can't realistically edit our genomes just yet to overexpress GNMT, the crux of the issue remains methionine, or perhaps more accurately, how our bodies struggle more and more to break down methionine and its breakdown products as we age, and how that detrimentally affects our health and shortens our lifespan. My name is Hashim, and I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, you can always subscribe for more of the same. See you all next week.